everyone, and welcome to Business Boutique. I'm Christy Wright, and I am hanging out with someone that's really no fun at all. Where is he? Dave Barnes, y'all. I'm so excited. Dave, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Ryan.
So we're just talking offline. We know all the same people.
We did.
We have friends from Young Life, friends from the UT world, Annie Downs. Annie connects. Annie knows everyone.
She does.
I met her for coffee one time, which was a mistake because we did not talk at all. It was every single revolving door
of people who knew,
all of her best
friends. And the volume of trivial conversations.
Sure. Yeah, we struggle with excitement and energy, enthusiasm, all the things. Dave, you are going to be speaking at, or you're going to be singing and playing at our Business Boutique event in Nashville, which is coming up soon. And I'm so excited because I've been a fan of yours for a while, but for anyone watching and listening that isn't familiar with a little bit about your story and kind of, you know, what you do. Tell us what you do.
Yeah, so I play music and sing and write. These days, so my career for really about the last 15 years, the first 15 years, was, you know, making my own records, playing shows, writing songs for myself. And then really about the last four or five years, I've been writing songs for other people too. So still doing my music and all of that, but also starting to write songs for other people and let them disperse.
Share them with the world.
And just started in the last couple of years doing stand-up.
Yes, I've noticed that. So I want to talk about that because I remember back in the day, a million years ago, when I was at Sharp Top Cove and you were the musician there. I had brought a group of girls for the week-long camp. I remember you were so funny. So even as I followed your music, I remember that about you. But it wasn't until, like you said, the last few years that you've incorporated that. So I want to talk about that in a minute. But let's go back to the beginning. When did you get your start and what did that look like? And even, did you know this is what you always wanted to do? Like from a kid, did you always know this is my thing?
Yeah. You know, so it's funny. A friend of mine just started a podcast ourselves called Dadville. And we had Drew Holcomb on, who's another Young Life.
Yeah, love Drew.
And Drew said this really well, and it really resonated with me, because it's hard to explain this to people, because I didn't grow up dreaming of doing music. In fact, I didn't really start doing music until really high school and then significantly in college. I played drums growing up, like drum set and stuff. So I went to college at MTSU thinking I was going to be like a guy that played on records or played on tours and stuff. And it was there that I started writing songs, and so everything just sort of, like, there wasn't a trajectory for that in my, I wasn't planning that. My family isn't, you know, Drew and I were laughing about that because there's always been a lot of simpatico with his and my stories because music just kind of came out of nowhere for both of us, and as he put it, you know, it feels like house money. It just feels like you're kind of, hey, this wasn't in the plan, and anything I have is a huge win, and so it wasn't something I set out to do. Now, once I started doing it and really felt like that was what I was supposed to be doing, you know, it was very focused and it's been like that since, but
you got intentional about it at that, at that point. You know, what's interesting is so many of the women in Business Boutique that are now running businesses say something similar where they're like, I didn't plan to have a business.
Yeah.
I never dreamt of being an entrepreneur. And the same is true for me, honestly. I never dreamt of being a speaker or author, but it was kind of, I just said yes to opportunities and then in those opportunities of figuring out as I went, I discovered gifts that I had that I didn't know that I had. And then, like you said, and then at some point I got intentional and kind of focused. So for you, what age were you or what happened that made you realize, I think I want to go for it? Like, this is not just a little hobby of playing music that brings me joy, but I think I'm going to do this for real. Like, when was that and what was that realization like?
That was probably, you know, so I'd gone through college starting to write songs and sort of, you know, dip my toe into the performing sort of world. Perform. It sounds like I was a dancer.
Sure. Yeah. We're just gonna leave it at that and see what people.
And cut. But as far as playing shows, and then really when I graduated and moved to Nashville, you know, the 25 miles north to Nashville, that was really when I started. I did 1 year here of just kind of doing a bunch of miscellaneous stuff because I didn't really have the artist thing going yet. I didn't have any product. Like, I didn't have a CD to sell. And so I did sort of a few different jobs, met my producer, a guy named Ed Cash, who is a really big CCM producer, but also does a bunch of projects like stuff like I do. And he was kind of, so halfway through my first year here, I worked for him for about 6 months, just kind of as his sort of errand boy, helped in the studio, whatever.
Just trying to get in that world.
And it was great. And it ended up being hugely providential because there, I actually met my manager who I've worked with my whole career because he was in a band that Ed was producing. Ed and I did my first record together. So there was so much productivity that came out of something that I didn't necessarily see, you know, again, just God's kindness of him going, you just trust me and stay.
Yeah, yeah.
Nope, stay.
Yeah, yeah. Go get some coffee.
Yeah, get the coffee. Go sweep the
and
deck
like,
one more time.
Why am I getting coffee? Yeah.
But you know, I think in retrospect, it was hugely providential that season, even that just that 6 months, because again, so much of my connections and my network of really important people to my career that I've worked with were in that 6 months. So it was kind of then that the fire really got lit that I was like, I think this is what I want to do. And then from there, oddly enough, the band that my manager was in at the time invited me to come open, me and a guy named Matt Wirsch, come open some shows for them. And then Matt and I did 2 weeks after that. That was the beginning of 2002, like January 2002. And then from there, it's been full-time ever since.
So once you got a taste of it, what was that like? Like your first being on stage, like you're kind of official at this point. What was it like once you got to experience that?
You know, and that's a great question, and I think what I'll say too to encourage listeners and the gals who are out there listening to this, I was very underqualified, and I can't speak to that enough. Like, we even sort of talked about this for a second before we started. Like, I think it's a real misnomer for people who are starting their businesses that you have to know what the heck you're doing. Because you don't. And I mean, literally, the first, I would really genuinely argue 5 to 6 years of my career, maybe longer, I didn't really know how to sing. I was singing, but thankfully because I was working with guys like Ed and you know, I'd have guys in the band that, you know, just people around me kind of going, because I had never sung. So it'd be like starting a business where you're going to make shoes and you've never
You don't know anything about it, right?
Yeah. So really, again, it's a testimony of just God's providential kindness and you know, affection for me.
Yeah.
But you know, it was really interesting because I was just learning as I went.
Right.
There was no roadmap. It was just kind of like every show I'd play, I'd go, oh, that made that easier. I should do that more. Or, and truthfully, I think a lot of the comedy stuff came out of, and again, sort of the plug and play lesson here is what you think you're working on, you may be honing another talent that becomes a part of your business or maybe become a different business. But for me, what made me calm on stage was talking. Because I could do that. I'd done skits and, you know, improv stuff growing up. And so I knew what it was like to be in front of people, and I loved that. The music part was tricky.
Okay.
So to calm myself down, I would talk. I'd tell stories, and then I'd get them back, and then I'd sort of get my way through a song. And so that was kind of where, you know, the more I did it, the more I went like, and you know, like I think as a lot of us see, people start to go, hey, this is really good. Like whatever your product is this is really great.
You're great at that. You should do that. Yeah.
So I think for me, it was you know, doing it enough that you kind of went, huh, like this, I love doing it, and it looks like I have the skill set to do it.
Yeah.
And now it's just putting your head down and sort of, you know, continue to do it to where you start going, I actually feel comfortable, and now I do feel like, you know, the 10,000 hours thing starts to come in.
Or it comes into play. I love how you talk about that job as kind of running errands and just intern or errand boy or whatever. Ken Coleman talks about the proximity principle of the people you're in proximity with. You have no idea the opportunities that will come out of just being in the place you want to be or around the type of people you want to be around, even if you're just getting coffee and sweeping floors. And I think now, especially with you know, social media, and you have the ability to compare everyone else's success, and you think, oh, that happened overnight. Like they just woke up one day, but they underestimate the grunt work or the daily grind or the nights that you'd write songs and you thought, this is bad.
Scary.
Yeah, no one's going to listen.
Oh, man.
So how long, from the time that you started doing music until you first had a song on the radio, how long was that? Do you have any idea off the top of your head? Like how many years?
So the first time probably would have been about, we did that record. There was a record called Brother Bring the Sun that was my first full length. There was a song on there called Until You, the Lightning 100 here in Nashville, played. So it was probably, you know, 4 years from beginning to having a song on
what
there.
What was that like? I mean, like having your song
on
the radio?
Everything you would imagine. It's the thing that, and again, and this is a big part of my story, is that was never, I didn't set out to do this.
Mm-hmm.
So the blessing was I didn't have expectations for it. So it wasn't.
Everything was bonus, like
I
you said.
Everything was house money. I was just glad that anything happened. And so, so it was amazing. I mean, literally a genuine, like, I didn't even know to dream this. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting in my car, and I'm having my friends, oh, dude, you're on Lightning 100, you know. And I got to be where I was like, okay, yeah, this is like, they play it every now and then, so I know.
I got it,
yeah.
I know, okay, cool,
So, and the worst part is when you're listening to it and your friend pulls up next to you. That's a real fun moment. Turn this off. What's up, what are you doing, you know. It's the best. It's the best. Still, I've got a few songs on the radio now that I've written for people and then myself. And I still, like, it's, you know, 40 years old, I'm still like,
yeah. Yeah, no, but there's always new milestones, too. Like, you had that first song on the radio, which I remember that album. I think you played in Knoxville when I was in college.
Yeah, I did.
And I remember you were so funny, the same thing. And so I loved that album. And now you look at where you are today, years later, and God Gave Me You was picked up by Blake Shelton and hit number one.
Yeah.
So, like, every single stage, there's still new milestones. There's still new things. What is, does it still have that feeling of, like, oh, my gosh, like, every new kind of thing that you never expected coming?
You know, I think one of the really hard things to hold in tension as you do your work and you sort of want to see it succeed is to not take for granted the success that you have, that you've already had, that continue. Mm-hmm. You know, so like when last summer I had a song called Craving You that Thomas Rhett and Maren Morris sang in the country world, it was number one, it was big. But, you know, God Gave Me You was the first big one. So this one's great, but now it's about getting the third one.
Uh-huh.
About, and so, you know, I've really been convicted over how do you walk that really fine line of going, man, I would love for this to happen more, and I'm working that it happens more, but gosh, I need to be here for this moment.
Because
it's not, because you start getting into that really tricky thing of like, well, then what? Well, then what? Well, then what's going to make me happy now? What's going to make me feel like I've succeeded?
Yeah.
And so I think it takes a lot of discipline for me, at least, to hold those moments as they come and really, because that's what you're doing. And I think that's what's hard to realize is this is the moment you worked for 6 months ago. And it's not what you're working for right now because you're already thinking ahead. But if you don't sell, you know, I heard somebody say the other day, the things that we don't celebrate, we lose. And I think there's a lot of truth to that. I think as a business owner, as someone who's, as an entrepreneur, I would say especially, that is really tricky because we, because then you start expecting things and then things become disappointments. And people are going, why can't you celebrate this success? Well, because it's not the... And you lose the joy of what our work, what the vocation is.
And it's this balance too, right? Because a lot of the women listening are wired like me, like drivers, achievers, like the next, you know. So it's this balance of like, you want to be goal-oriented. You want to have direction in your life. You want to make an impact and help people. But to your point, you don't want it to always be that thing. And think, I think there's really the myth of thinking that thing is going to be the thing where you've made it. Like, I remember, I've used this example before, Dave, but I remember the first time I got booked to be on Fox and Friends. So this is national media. And I was like, I mean, my Twitter's going to crash.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to have so many followers that we literally crash the Twitter site because I got three, maybe. Like, it's like, maybe three.
Yeah.
Like, we think that one thing is going to be the thing, but it's the years, it's the decades of the grind. It's all the chopping wood and hits that leads to now you're living today, the thing that you prayed years for, you know, and celebrating where you are today. And like you said, acknowledging that. But I think, you know, with business, a lot of times the metrics of success might be Facebook followers or any social media metric or top line revenue and thinking, well, if I could make that much, if I could have that many followers, I will have made it. And there's never a number.
Yeah.
Like, there's always more, you know? And I think there's a real myth, too, of the amount of followers that you have equates to the amount of value you give. And it's easy, like you said, it's easy to get caught up in that. It's easy to get caught up in that comparison world. Now,
well, and I think I'll add to that. I think one of the things that has become a real discipline for me is trying to build margin into my vocation, meaning, if I'm always working for myself and I'm the one that's, and I'm the one working for myself all the time, then I really am gonna lose when I lose and I'm gonna win when I win. And that's great when you win, but it really hurts when you lose. And I think something as a Christian man that I'm having to do is to go, okay, this is one, not who I am, to your point, but I have to give God some space in my vocation because I need wins I don't do because it gives me perspective. I'm not the driver of this thing. I've been given something to take care of, but that thing did not originate with me and it won't end with me. And so I think as we do these callings, as we do our vocations, if you don't give yourself space in that calling, it's gonna kill you. Because again, you'll win with the wins, but you lose big when you lose big. And I think instead going, okay, I wanna work as hard as I can to do this thing, but this isn't all my life. And even within this, I need to give some mystery space. I need to give that, this call came from nowhere and they ordered a whole box. I don't even know this.
Right.
Thank you, Lord.
Right.
Not like, good, because I've been wearing them out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it'll kill you.
I have been stalking them.
Oh, I've posted 5,000 times. And so I think for me, too, it's a real discipline of kind of like the more I do it going, I'm going to do the best that I can with this. Yeah. But I can't do this all the time. I have a family that I care deeply about. I have a wife. I can't. So there's got to be some time that I just go, you just kind of like a kite in the air, sort of let it go and go, all right, I could work the next 3 hours of today, but I know I'm needed right now and we got something going on, so I'm done right now.
Yeah.
And Lord, if this, you know, help me with that and honor this and just do what you do. And so I think that's been a new discipline too. The longer I do it, is kind of going, what sort of shields me from some of those moments is going, if I can have big wins that aren't mine, then it's easier for me to lose because it's not just me.
That's right. You know? I love that. I love the idea of mystery time, like a little bit of margin in there and just leaving room for that. And you said something else too. You said, this is not mine. I've been given something.
Yeah.
And what's interesting, Dave, is a lot of the women that I work with, they have gifts or skills or talents or education. They're really, really smart.
Yeah.
And maybe they are a stay-at-home mom or they're working in a full-time job they don't like, whatever their reason is for branching out to do their own thing. There seems to be, especially with women, this struggle with, I feel selfish because I love it so much. Like, surely I couldn't charge for this or make an income or make a living doing this because I love it. So those can't go hand in hand. And it's interesting because I love how you described it as almost being a steward of these gifts.
That's right. I've been given these gifts.
So when you look at it that way, you're not selfish for using your gifts. It's stewardship.
Yeah.
It's, you have a responsibility to help people and use those gifts.
And
I love that perspective.
And make no, and I mean, I can't say this clear enough, and I think that's a great point. Men are the same. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not, I think we have to be careful when we think of genders as the, as what they can be set up as, because the truth is I have to be the same. Like, I don't need to overwork.
Right.
I don't need to
under, that's
and I
right.
think, as I think about women, I think about the same thing. I'm like, each of us, I have to build family time into my schedule.
Right.
Like, that has to matter to
me.
That's a discipline thing. And I think the same for women. And so I think it's tricky because, you know, I think both genders, as different as we are and wonderful as we are, they're the same disciplines.
Right.
You know,
and we struggle with it maybe in a different way.
Like
I think people, I speak on life balance a lot and time management and how we work through all the things that we have to do. I think people think of life balance as a woman's issue, and it's not. Like,
that's
men
right.
in entrepreneurship,
exactly right.
men in business, they struggle with balancing their time and being pulled in a million directions and all of that. I want to ask about something about values, because I really teach in Business Boutique for women to know what their values are and build their business around their values. And one of the things I know about you, and I don't know in detail, so I want you to describe it in your own words, but you really value, especially when you're starting out, like this, going about this the independent way. Like, you wanted to be independent. Talk to us a little bit about, like, when did you make that decision, and what did that mean to you early on? Because that was a difficult decision, certainly early in your career.
I think it's really helpful, I think, when you're sort of building your business, to know yourself really well. And values, I think that's great, and it's really true. Like, you know, when you think about your values, what are the things that hopefully 30 years from now I'm gonna still feel, that I'll still value? And when you build your business along that line, then it's gonna be easier because, one, it's who you are, and it's built to your schedule, it's built to your specifications, your time, and then your values. And so I think for me, the independent thing for me was always, I know myself, and it's not that I don't play well with others, but I have a really strong opinion about a lot of things. And so I just kind of knew, by the grace of God, it's not that I'm better than anything. It's not that I'm less than anything. I just know that I'm going to do better in certain scenarios. And I want to give a certain amount of time to this career, and I don't want to give a certain amount of time to this career. So by the grace of God, as those things came into my life, I was able to sort of go, and with friends' help, you know, with mentors and everything, kind of going, okay, that's an interesting opportunity. I get excited about these two things, but I dread 10 of these. Okay, like, and then as I went along, and again, it's really the kindness of the Lord, just as he brought these opportunities, because, you know, it was just a real grace. But, you know, when I worked for this independent label out of New York called Razor and Tie for 5 or 6 years, it was a perfect fit because they came in and said, look, you can retain, like, a lot of the ownership of this stuff. Like, we don't need your publishing. We can do a joint venture on these records. And so I was like, this is great. And they were like, go make your records, bring them in. Like, as long as they aren't terrible, we'll put them out.
Right.
And that all catered to my skill set and the way I wanted to do. Now, granted, I took a huge hit because I didn't sign with the major label.
That's right.
I took it. So I knew what
sacrifices.
Was involved. There was huge sacrifices.
Right.
But I'm so thankful that as I look at the arc of my career, it's smooth.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't feel like these hiccups where I'm down.
Right.
It's been a really nice, consistent journey because I think early on I just knew, you know, I need to pay attention to these things, these inclinations I have and these tendencies Somebody told me one time, it's one of my favorite quotes of all time, says, you'll never be tomorrow what you're not becoming today. Mm. And a lot of people I know can think about that and think like, oh, then if I want to be in shape, I need to start running. Mm. And that is true. And this is why I love this quote, because it works in every tense of time. But I think of it more retrospectively, because I think a lot of people with business may meet you and go, I want to be an author so bad. I want to be a speaker. How do I do that? And you go, my first question is, what have you done the last 5 years? Because they'll go, oh, well, I've done this and I've done that. I'm like, well, then you probably don't want to do that. Because if you really want to do that, I imagine you would be writing. Because then when I sit with someone and they go, hey, I want to, you know, thanks for getting called from me. I want to be a singer-songwriter. And I go, well, what have you been doing? They're like, I made a record last year. I played it. And I'm like, then yeah.
Great.
You do. Because you can look
evidence,
back.
Yeah.
You have evidence of these things. And so I think that's a big deal. Because when you see what you want, how you work, to kind of put your business plan together in a way, even which I never did, but I think I just knew it in my brain.
Yeah.
You know, I never did like a mission statement.
Yeah.
But I think for me, just knowing like, I kind of like playing around this many shows. I like these kinds of people. These are the kind of people I work the best with. I like this kind of freedom. I like this kind of ownership, whatever. That as I've made decisions, that's always been the sort of grid I've made those decisions through.
Yeah.
And it's really benefited me because we've been super consistent with that, even though it's called sacrifices.
Right,
you know,
not
being able to do other things.
But it was short-term sacrifices in the beginning. And now even the way that your music has evolved, it's still true to you. It's still something you love and you're proud of. You wake up and you're excited to go to it. And you know, one of the things I see all the time, Dave, is because women are so excited when they start out, they think, well, if I say no to that opportunity that they dread, eight of the 10 things, if I say no to it, well, that's the only open door I'm going to get, or I'm leaving money on the table. But what happens is they say yes in a lot of the wrong places without having those values kind of as that, you know, compass directing them where they need to go. And they wake up one day, 2 years, 3 years, five years down the line, and they're going to a business they hate.
That's
their business. Like, you created this business so that you would love it, so
that's
that you could work for yourself and call the shots, and you wake up every day going to a job you hate.
And, well,
and that's
just
the saddest thing.
Well, the two things I think about so much when you say that is, one, it like everything in life, in my opinion, as a Christian man, I think it's about faith. It's about going, do I believe that God has his best intentions for my life? Because if I do, then I'm going to have a lot more confidence making decisions.
Yeah.
And going, this is going to be so much money. I've never made that kind of money, but that is not what I want to do. And so you go, Lord, I have to trust that you made me. I'm wonderfully made in your image, and I don't want to do that. So I'm foregoing this money and sitting with my husband, you know, with me, with my wife, going, she goes, okay, well, then don't do it.
Right.
Because she and I both go, we'll survive through this.
Like, that's right.
God is big. And I think, too, to your point, and this is so important, I think, and you've said this so well, you want to build a brand that is who you are.
Right.
Whatever that looks like.
Right.
Whatever size that is. And I, you know, there was a Jason Isbell, who's a singer-songwriter, lives here in Nashville now, but he had a quote, and I'm going to butcher this, but basically the gist of it was, be careful how you think of people's success, because not everybody wants the same thing.
Mm.
And I thought, you know, that's a wonderful quote, because some people, for me, you know, I played the Ryman 2 weeks ago here in Nashville, and that is
the
that
ultimate.
Might as well be playing at the Coliseum
in
Rome.
That's right.
Now, to some people, that's the stepping stone to, you know, to Bridgestone.
Right.
But for me, it is like
the
let's
ultimate.
Throw the
that's
deuces
right.
and I'm out.
Yeah.
So I think you got to be careful when we think about those things, and but that's my brand. Like my brand is. That's
Ryman,
who I am.
Totally.
You know, and I think, you know, to encourage everybody who's listening or watching this, I think that's a big deal, is to go, what are the things that you want and you want to do, and then build your career toward those things.
Yeah.
And then celebrate them if they happen.
Right.
Like, this is what you're working for. And to make sure that your brand is who you are. Because I mean, if I've seen one thing in music, I've seen this a million times, where you have a sound, you move to Nashville, I sit with you and I go, this is you are killing this.
Yes.
And it's like, right. And then somebody comes in
and
goes, you're this good looking dude, girl. Mm-hmm. Have you tried doing this thing? And they've got a bunch of clout.
That's
and
right.
you go, this feels like a real
That's
opportunity.
What I'm supposed to do. They know better. They know better than I do. They know
and then
me better.
Three records in, I'm sitting 6 years later and they're like, I'm miserable.
Mm-hmm.
I hate doing this.
Yeah.
I don't like the songs I've got out.
Right.
I don't like the way I'm being portrayed.
Right.
And I think that's the worst, that's a nightmare to me, you know?
Yeah.
Because there wasn't you didn't stick to your brand.
Yeah.
Because it was going to mean sacrifice.
Right.
It was going to mean someday, you know, I just hope that when I'm 80,000 years old and, you know, sitting there looking back on this, that I go, it was just unique to me.
Yeah, yeah.
That was it.
I remember in college, there was this moment, and this hasn't happened to me many times in my life where I literally felt God speak to me, but it was one of those moments in college, and I was in my car, and there's this woman, you may actually know her from UT people, Jana Spica, her and her husband Chuck, she's an author and speaker, and she mentored me in college. And I remember praying kind of in my head and thinking, Lord, I wish, I just pray that I could even just be half of what Jana is. Mm. And I felt God say, no, I want you to be you. Mm. And the message in that, like, that just went through my body was, that was more right, not better in a comparison type of way, but I think, you know, we see something, and it's good to have goals, and it's good to have models and mentors and all that type of thing, but we think, I want to be her, or I want to be him. And I love how just uniquely God created us, that he has something so specifically for us.
That's right.
And maybe you don't see someone doing what you want to do because you're going to do something no one's ever done before.
And I tell you, too, to have the faith to trust that in that you are going to thrive is hard.
Because
you see left and right, you see Instagram, you see they've got three times as many followers, but I'm doing what I want to do, but God, I want to have that.
Right.
But I think the thing that, this is the biggest piece of faith, I think, maybe in the vocational space as a Christian, is going, that is actually when I'm going to be doing my best work. And I have to trust that when I'm doing what I was made to do, I will be so, and it doesn't mean you're not going to have discipline. It doesn't mean that you have to have discipline to be careful at what you let in.
Right.
And going and seeing something and going, but, you know, and I think that's so much of the work you have to do as an entrepreneur is going, I just have to trust that when I'm doing what I was made to do, that I'm going to thrive.
Yeah.
That I'm going to feel that calling, that yes, you get up in the morning and I can't wait to get into
work.
Right.
Know? And there's room for you. Like there's room for you in the marketplace. There's room for you in music for your unique style and voice and perspective. It doesn't have to, even if someone else is doing something similar, it doesn't take away from what God wants to do through you. Thanks so much for watching, and don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you want to download my free goal setting tool to get started on your goals, you can click the link below.